week and this are kind of a two-part series. Last week in the sermon, we dealt a little bit with the tension around whether or not you have to choose between a deep and serious religious life or community and a joyful one. This week, a little bit about how we would go about as individuals in this room, or religious progressives, or just people who walked in here by accident today, but how we would go about being a mechanism for displaying or sharing or showing joy, or even at a minimum, just good news. I'm going to start today by introducing you to a man named Yedrin Smolovich. This is a picture of him. So, this is Yedrin Smolovich. He's often called the cellist of Sarajevo. 1992, formerly known as Yugoslavia, this country was breaking apart with different groups declaring their independence, and in what became the largest, longest, and in some ways a very brutal siege of a capital city, the longest siege of a capital city in modern warfare, Sarajevo was being shelled, bombed, there were snipers and tanks surrounding the city, much of the infrastructure had been destroyed, and there were a few places left in town where people could get food. One day in 1992, there was a group of families lined up at one of the last remaining bakeries in town waiting to buy bread. When mortar fire came down and blew up the gathered group, killing 22 individuals. This was in Yedrin Smolovich's neighborhood. He was the principal cellist for the orchestra in Sarajevo. He said he was so upset, so infuriated, so scared, so alone to see these bodies on the street, to have lost friends, for his city to be torn apart. He didn't know what to do, and so he put on his coat and tails that he uses to play, picked up his cello and a little stool, and walked to the ruins of a bombed-out building in his neighborhood and put his stool down and sat on the cello and began to play and offer the only thing that he knew how to do, playing the cello. And so he decided that for 22 days straight, in honor of the 22 people that were killed, he would play Albinoni's Adagio in G minor. And so imagine in the ruins of that bombed-out city, in a building where 22 people had just been killed, in the midst of sniper fire and rockets being formed, the screams of people in pain, you hear this sound in that context.
Despair, he brought the only thing that he knew how to do really well.
and he's been an inspiration to some others. In fact, the conductor of the symphony orchestra of Iraq has been doing the same thing. When there have been terrorist attacks and cafes or schools have been blown up, he's been taking his cello and other musicians and instruments and sitting, getting as quickly as possible to the site of the destruction and immediately beginning to play at the risk of their own lives, because it is a threat to those who are carrying out the attacks. The person who leads the orchestra in Iraq said that he was inspired by this, and that the reason for doing it, he said, is that right now in his life, so many people decide how you get to die, but no one will get to choose how he gets to live. And that it was worth it to infuse beauty into moments of suffering. The other day, I was getting ready to get on the on-ramp to I-35. And I got shopping for some stuff I didn't need. I was getting into my car that costs more than it probably needs to. I could ride my bike, I guess. It was a stoplight. I'm kind of feeling guilty for buying some stuff. That's how I do things. And I looked over, and I saw the woman sitting next to me at the red light in the car beating the steering wheel with her fists. Just beating it. I thought, what's wrong? You don't want to look over and stare. But I couldn't look away. There she was. She wasn't angry. She was weeping. In broad daylight, at a stoplight, she was heaving. I could see the tears through my window and hers just streaming down her face, and she was beating the steering wheel as hard as I've ever seen someone. Rail thin. And just light turned green, and we both went, and she didn't stop. The car moved, but she didn't stop. I found myself wondering what on earth she was going through. And it reminded me of a simple fact, and one that we get the privilege as clergy to understand from time to time, is that she is everywhere. Everywhere. One of the gifts that we get, it sounds strange to lift it up as a gift, but it is to be invited into people's lives when they're willing to bear witness to that. To the kind of thing that her coworkers probably didn't see. Maybe her spouse or partner or friends don't know about. But in the privacy of that safe space of a car, for whatever reason or day in that moment, she was able to beat her fists against the wheel. And sometimes we get the gift and the honor and the privilege of being with people to see behind the veil a little bit. Even though we get to do that, I still forget. That's everywhere. I look out today and I see you, and I have the privilege of knowing a lot of you in a way that is personal. Almost everybody whose story I know has that in it. Yeah, mostly. Almost everybody. So the suffering of the world is not always as immediate and obvious as a war zone. It's not always that we know people are suffering or there's pain in the world because there's a bombed out building or shells or sniper fire. But I promise you, always there. As much as there is joy, and as much as the poem said that even though there are children starving, and they will be starving anywhere, we're still called to produce delight in the lives of ourselves and others. What we don't always see is that there is hidden joy and hidden suffering everywhere. So much of it in this room. Let me just believe me. So much. So what do we do in the context of knowing that whether or not there's bombs falling or mortar shells, everywhere in some way has an interior war zone, a depth of real difficulty? We've inherited from the Protestant tradition, at least in this congregation, the obligation and the mandate to share good news. That's what the word gospel means. And though you and many people realize that what has been shared as the gospel for much of the Christian tradition has not been good news to a lot of people, we've retained the idea that if what we're building together does not propose a viable good news alternative to the reality of suffering, then it probably is just a social club, or a band-aid, or a distraction. That if someone says, "What good news does this congregation have to share, or do you have to share?" we should likely have an answer. And so, instead of just kind of asking to raise your hands, my guess is that some of us struggle with it. I know I come here because I want to be around people who share my values, and I know that it makes me feel more hopeful to be in this place, and I know that right now the world is in what seems to be a terrible, precarious situation, but what is it that people get here that they don't get somewhere else? If you were asked to stand up and say, "Look, I know it's hard, but," what would you do? And most of us say, "Well, I've got an answer, but not me. I don't want to be the person to share it. I'm not smart enough. I don't speak well enough. I'm not trained enough. I'm not good looking enough. I don't have enough money. Right now is really not the time. You see, I'm taking care of the stuff at the house, and I'd rather not stand up and tell people my good news." There's a long tradition in all spiritual traditions of saying, "Yes, but not me. I'm sure that the church could provide some good news, and I'll leave it to the church." Those of you who are familiar with the story of Moses in the Hebrew Scriptures know that that's about all he ever says. Yahweh, the regional god of the Hebrew people at that time, has to trick him, sneak up on him in the form of a burning bush. "Moses, hello, hello." Finally, he says, "No, thank you. I'm not really good at this speaking thing. You see, I'm a stutterer. I don't know why you would ask me, a person who trembles on my lips, to stand up and give a message to others." And in typical Hebrew Scriptures fashion, the God Yahweh says, "Just do it, please." And then Moses goes back and says, "Have you met these people? Seriously? Can I choose some other people? They've been complaining for a long, long time. It's all they seem to do. My brother Aaron's a real jerk. Come on, pick somebody else here. The context is terrible." And then, as the pattern goes, the God Yahweh says, "Just do it. Please, I'll give you a little help, but it's you. Now's the time, and you're the person." I do understand the trembling lips, "Why me" phenomenon very intimately. I still don't get it. Why on earth you let us do this? Why you devote 15, or more likely when I'm preaching, 20 minutes to a period before you let us stand up and say anything? Maybe I'll leave Beth out of this. Why me? Yeah, we have a degree, and we're not scared to talk in public, or at least we don't admit to you how scared we are of it. We have no moral high ground. None. If you only knew. Well, Beth does. I don't have any connection to God that's stronger than yours. Not enlightened. It's hard to do my job. Struggling enough right now that you're coming. keep one. And I get that. But we do have a tradition of saying that the message of this church is not just what gets spoken from the pulpit. I wonder if in your mind you can call to your imagination the people in your life who have been a big yes in the midst of life's suffering. Who is it that you know who, when life has been difficult, just seeing them in a room was enough? That's a good place to start. Following the lead of a person like that. We inherited also from the Protestant tradition the idea of the prophethood and the priesthood of all believers. Basically, that means nobody can tell you what you saw or heard. Your relationship with the Holy is yours and nobody else's to dictate for you. But in a progressive church, we also expanded that to be the prophethood of all believers, which means that the message of a hopeful future is also in your hands. That you are as close to the source of hope as us, or the church, or Jesus, or the Buddha, or any prophet, or sinner, or saint who's ever moved across the earth. And therefore, it means that in some way, if you have access to the source of hope as much as anyone else, someday somebody's going to come asking. Nobody's perfect. Nobody knows it all. Nobody can do it all. We can't all stop a war. We can't all feed every hungry person. We can't stand up to every oppression and the world is calling. We can't play all songs or heal all bodies. We can't speak to all people, but everybody can do something. In a world that feels very overwhelming to me right now, one thing that gives me hope is knowing that each and every person in this room can identify something that you are uniquely equipped to give to the world. I know it seems hard, but maybe you're the person who can play beautiful music. Maybe you have the money to give to people who need it. Maybe you know how to heal a body or to draw a picture that makes someone feel better. Maybe you can write poetry. Maybe you're the person all your friends come to share what they're going through, and your silence is the biggest gift. But my guess is you've got something. Whether or not it's in a war zone, or the car next to you on the highway, or the person sitting next to you in the pews, or your children, or your friends, or your family, or the city, somebody is waiting and watching to see what your great yes might be. When you find it, even if your lips might tremble, may you speak.